We are fashioned after Mobile Mondays, which is an organization that has chapters in other parts of the country. You can visit our website at mobileportland.com, and we've also got a really active Google group with the URL up on the screen. You can find all that information on our website as well. We've got a lot of upcoming events, and I'm not going to go through each one of them right now, but I'll show you them quickly, and you can, again, go to our website to get details about each one of them. Our next Mobile Portland meeting is May 23rd. Same time, same place. There is a seriously hardcore phone gap training in Portland coming up on May 1st. That's actually this Sunday. So if you're interested in learning more about phone gap, you can get information at the URL at the bottom of the screen. A couple other events we wanted to touch base about. There's the Web Directions Unplugged, May 12th through 13th in Seattle. And Mobile Northwest is May 16th, also in Seattle. And the last one is Web Visions, which is local here, May 25th through 27th at the Convention Center. Some upcoming Mobile Portland events. In May, we're going to be talking about,
I'm sorry.
Yep.
So,
Right, so May, so Jason just let me know, May we're moving to Wednesdays instead of Mondays so that Josh Clark from Tabworthy can come and talk to us. So note that'll be Wednesday and not Monday. In June, we're gonna be talking about mobile health. In July, we're going into OSCON, a tie-in with OSCON. August, we're focusing on mobile analytics. September will be about nonprofits, and October will be about mobile advertising. So we don't have details yet on each one of those, but we're trying to set themes for the months going out. So that's what we'll be covering. We like to always take a moment and let people talk about any job openings or opportunities or announcements that they have out there. So if you have a job opening, you want to stand up and, you know, tell us about it? Yeah, go ahead.
Yes, Scott Metrics is hiring iPhone programmers, senior iPhone programmers.
Right. Anyone else?
Contract account.
Sure.
My name is Chris Akins. I have a new company called Bike Track. It is, we are developing a GPS device that you attach to a bicycle so that you can track it if it's stolen. We are looking for an app developer for that. We have hardware and our business development going, and we like an app developer. So if anybody would like to talk to us.
I'm Adam Wolf. I make an iPhone application called Here File File. It lets you access all of your Mac's files on your iPhone wherever you are. And we're looking for iOS contractors to help us out with our iPhone version as well as an iPad version. Thanks.
I'm Sheetan Dubey. I started a new startup called AudioNate.com. That's the idea in which that startup began, and I took my job to go forward with it. I'm looking for a tech co-founder, ideally, but otherwise some tech advisors who will help me try and look at, you know, how to take driving forward. So it's all people thought it is interested. I would love to reach you.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Hi, my name is Jeff Horton. I'm a partner with a marketing company. It's a mobile marketing company called Winsnap. We primarily work with QR codes and strategies. Around QR codes to get people to interact with them. We're having a seminar on May 4th in Beaverton. I've got a bunch of cards for it. It's just a 2-hour morning seminar. It's only $10.
Right here.
Hi, I'm Matt. I work for a company called Transport, and we're doing a mobile web-based version of our freight matching application. We're probably looking for some front-end web development help.
I guess I just wanted to say that we even have a sort of honest finding fee for an iPhone program.
Thanks. Yeah, in the back.
I actually have a game called Wild Game Hunt. I need a couple of people to help me with the sort of technical stuff. Should be doing it into smartphone size.
company, a graphic design, graphic design shop, so it's also for me.
All right. Cool. So we're going to delve right into the Demolicious part of this. So we're working with Portland Web Innovators to bring five really cool apps that everyone's going to get 10 minutes to talk about their app. We'll have a couple minutes afterwards for questions. Everybody got a token or two tokens, right? Does anyone need tokens? Does anyone know what the tokens are for? I will tell you, you do, I know. So at the end, you'll get to vote on the app that you like the most. So we have these jars, we'll put them somewhere that you can get to them. It's not a great place to live.
I got a lot of votes here, folks.
He needs one here. So at the end, drop your tokens in the jar for the app that you like the most for whatever reason. And then the winner gets bragging rights, yeah, which is pretty cool in and of itself. So, all right, I think we're just going to get started. We've got Justin Miller from Mapbox here who's going to kick it off. 10 minutes, I'm going to set my timer. So it'll probably, hopefully, bark when it's time for him to be done. So Justin, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Justin Miller. I work with a company called Development Seed, which is a small company, about a dozen people, based out of Washington, D.C., but I'm one of a handful of people working remotely. Of course, I'm in Portland. I'm here to talk about Mapbox, which is mapping stuff that is probably of interest to anybody working on the web or mobile. And I'm going to lay a little bit of groundwork because our app, a lot of times I go right into the app itself and people are like, why? What is this good for? So I'm going to throw a lot of info at you about where this actually came from and then show the app at the end of that. So, like I said, the company. Is that better?
Yeah.
So, as I mentioned, the company's called Development Seed. The company's been around a little bit over 8 years, and what we've done traditionally is strategic consulting around websites and data visualization with a lot of groups in developing countries, generally. And what ended up happening is, over time, we kept building lots and lots of maps, and we decided to kind of turn inward and focus our investments on building out this stack of map tools for other people to use and do it in an open source way so that developers can get a hold of it. And that's Mapbox. So why maps? Maps tell stories, and we found it to be a very powerful way to help visualize things, especially when you're talking about the kind of work we have been doing in the past, which is with international development in lots of countries around the world that people didn't necessarily know where they were or things like that. And something on a map is often much, much more powerful than a spreadsheet-style table with, say, zip code data or something like that. You can start aggregating and clustering things in a geographically visual way, and it starts to make sense. These are some of the projects we've done with outside investment in countries related to health. This is related to unmanned drone strikes in Pakistan as compared to Bush and Obama, things like that. Data visualizations with the Department of Education, open election data, Afghanistan, Nigeria, and things with a lot of different groups just related to plotting their and showing their users and constituents. So the basic kind of unit of all this stuff is map tiles. And if you've ever done anything with Google Maps or a lot of other web-based map APIs, you're probably familiar with this idea. For any given map kind of zoom level, you have tiles and it breaks them up into images. And then these images all get stitched together to make a map. And so you might ask why custom maps? Getting ahead of all the questions that you'd ask if I just went straight into the app. You've probably seen this kind of app on an iPhone, or this kind of thing on the web, or this kind of thing on an iPad, and they start to look the same after a while. And perhaps you might not be able to work in an online environment, something like Google Maps would require, or perhaps your data or client or whatever is incompatible with their terms of service. As an interesting side note, this is Apple's icon for their core location framework, which they put out a long time ago, and you can see even they didn't use Google Maps. Coincidentally, we actually, unrelated to that, we built a map like this some time ago. So this is an actual usable map on an iPad or on the web. It's called Geography Class, and it zooms just like you'd zoom a Google map. And so this is the kind of thing we like to build because it's very custom. So portable maps, how does this tie into mobile? Basically, if you've got map tiles, for a given zoom level, say you want to get all the way down to the street level of a country, that can be millions of maps. So how do you take millions of map tiles and make them usable? You know, how do you transfer those over USB or over the network, or how do you share those, and how do you kind of aggregate those together? What we did is come up with a tile, like a format called MP Tiles. And for any developers in the room, this is just SQLite-based stuff. So it's a way of storing millions and millions of map tiles in there. And we've come up with some tools for building maps. So we made a tile map studio called Tile Mill that lets you do this in a web browser, build your own custom maps in a CSS kind of way. We did a product called TileStream, which is another open source web-based thing. These are both written in Node.js, and all in the last 6 months, by the way. We've just really gotten into this stuff. And this is a way of serving your map tiles and making them available to all your applications or your mobile clients. And then what I'm going to show, what I work on, is the iPad app for kind of carrying these maps everywhere, using them offline, and sharing them and presenting them. It's kind of a keynote for maps. And as I mentioned, most of this stuff is open source. Here's some of the projects that we've kicked out of this work. Tile Mill itself is open source. Tile Stream is open source. The spec around this file format for doing things with map tiles in a custom way is open source. Command line utilities. Cardo is that CSS-like command line, silent language for styling your own maps. Wax is a way of dealing with interactivity on maps in JavaScript. Tile Live is a way of serving those tiles. Simple KML is a project I wrote for iOS, for the iPhone and the iPad, for parsing KML data, which is what you see in Google Earth. There are not a whole lot of apps that are doing a lot of rich data visualizations with that. So this is an open source library for that. Fingertips is an open source library for putting into your Cocoa application. It'll show where people are touching on the screen. I'll show this in a moment. So when you're demoing mirrored off of an iPad, the presenter's fingers show up on the projector. And then Wrap is a project we use for, this one I have an asterisk next to, we fork this. This is what we use for the map rendering on the iPad. But we maintain a fork of it, and we're contributing a lot back to it. So these are just some of the open source projects we're generating around this, and we want people to use and get a hold of. And we've got all this stuff up on GitHub. And one last thing before the app, I wanted to give a sneak peek of, as it happens tomorrow, we are relaunching Mapbox.com with some more commercial offerings around these things. So besides getting into the open source tools, if you want something in a more kind of enterprise environment, that's what we're working on. So this is what the site's going to look like. We're going to be cloud hosting these tile images in a highly redundant way that didn't go down last week when it was created. We're making an appliance that if you're not into hosting it yourself, maybe you want an appliance inside your office or behind your firewall. Relaunching things like Tile Stream hosted service that gives you analytics around your maps. So you get the standard stuff like where are people coming from and what web browsers are they using, but also which of my maps, map tiles are the most popular. So in the analytics, we have maps to show you about the maps. So yeah, let me show you the app a little bit. This is the app. This is that geography class map I mentioned. This is the app. Try three. This is the app and that geography class map that I mentioned. So this is a custom map view that we're doing. This is all happening offline. So this actually, this one is not particularly deep. This goes from something like the whole world view down to a zoom level like that. But I can show you something that we did. This is what ships with the app. We're able to do this in something like, it's a relatively large app. It's 200 megs to download. But this tile set ships with the app. So right off the bat, you can do things at a pretty high level. And this is the little dots of that fingertips library I mentioned, which you can put in your own iPad app. It just detects when you've got a monitor hooked up and does that. We've got some other ones, like these are tile sets that we've built and then bundled and made available. You can use these on web pages as well. So the kind of stuff that this is useful for, besides just showing the maps, is we've started working on things like map interactivity. Like this is related to the earthquake that happened last month in Japan. So you can start getting information about, so we've built in interactivity into the pixels, so it knows what pixels you're touching, things like that. And this is all spec'd in that MB tile spec as well. We've worked on things like alpha transparency and map tiles. So in this case, I'm showing the linen background that comes on the iPad, but you could put blue behind it or something like that. So those are, here's something else we've done for the city of Baltimore. We call it Baltimore Retro. Kind of a cooler looking map than you might see from other sources. And then what we do on top of all this and what this app is really good for is data visualizations. So something like, let's see. This is an RSS feed. And so we're able to cluster the points. So then when you get a bunch together, you can do things like that and then zoom in and refocus on what you're actually looking at. Really close together. Let me do another one over here. Something like that. So when you go into a particular area, it starts to break them up when you get a little closer. And then we've got loading and saving of your maps. So once you set up kind of a map state, you could go between different ones and load them up. Okay? That's all I've got.
Thank you. Two or three questions before we move on to the next.
So how much is committed to rugby? Is it compatible or rugby? Is everything there?
Yeah. If I heard you right, you said how much have we committed to rugby library? So rugby is the library we're using for the iPad app. The iPad app itself is closed source. Everything thus far that I've done, except for that interactivity of pixel encoding stuff, which I'm working on open sourcing right now, has been contributed back. So basically what RouteMe does, all these map tiles, it does OpenStreetMap and stuff like that out of the box, and I put in a back end for MB tiles and improving that and releasing it in stages when I can. But yeah.
Another question? Did you have a question?
That works on the iPhone too, by the way. And I put some demo code up for that if you're interested in putting that in an iPhone or iPad app.
How does licensing work on the iPhone?
Licensing of The question is, how does licensing work of the open source libraries?
Yeah.
All that stuff is BSD licensed, so it is free for you to use and closed source and resell as you see fit. So everything we've released is pretty much no strings attached.
Time for one more question. Anyone?
The question is, I mentioned SQLite. Do I support Postgres as well? SQLite is what that tile format is based on, and that's the only thing. So when you write a back end for it, like say in Cocoa or something like that, you would pull the map tiles out. But we did it that way because that works on desktop and servers for Linux and the tile serving stuff as well as on the iPhone and iPad, because SQLite's cross-platform, it's just a file. So yeah, it's not really as a database level, it's as a portable file.
Thanks so much. Next, we have Joe Janaga and Tony Jamesbury from Gigbook.
Yes.
So you guys are hooking up your iPad, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, you.
Okay.
You. Okay, I'm going to start talking while Tony is setting this up. First, we wanted to thank Mobile Portland for having us come and demo Gigbook for you all. My name is Joe Janiga, and this is Tony James Berry. We're the co-founders of Deep Dish Designs. We're a company based here in Portland, and we created an app called Gigbook. It's a sheet music viewer for musicians on stage. We designed and conceived of this in partnership with Woolly Beast Software, who developed this for us. A little background about Gigbook. We started conceiving of Gigbook back in November 2009 and began working on the mock-ups and ideas of this in February of 2010 and combined with Woolly Beast to execute it. And we finally launched it in October of 2010, and it's being used by a lot of musicians around the nation and the world, actually. A little bit about Gigbook also is that from the beginning, our thoughts of this app was to make it usable on stage by musicians, usable in the practice room by musicians, and usable in the classroom by musicians. And that's the mobile aspect of this, that everybody was going to be able to use it and put all of their music into it and use it on stage. So Tony is going to walk you through the demo of this, and I'll hand this over to Tony.
Thanks, Joe. Sorry, I'm battling a cold, so my voice is a little deeper. It would be good if I was singing today, maybe. But so the first thing that when we, like Joe said, when we developed Gigbook, we actually started before the iPad came out. We got the iPad, and then we pretty much scrapped 90% of our look, actually. Because once we started playing with the iPad, we didn't like what we came up with. We were basing it mostly on iPhone and on iTouch. And so what we wanted to do is, you know, a lot of musicians are technophobes, and we wanted to make something that was familiar to them, that they could instantly, when they saw it, they could recognize, you know, what we wanted them to do. I don't know what that is. That's not me. There we go. That's what we need. So we set up Gigbook with things that were familiar to them. One, we have a library, an all scores library. Most musicians would understand that. We also put in binders. Most musicians understand binders, especially if you are like Joe or myself, you carry around 1,000 pages of music constantly with you. And that gets heavy. I play double bass, so carrying a 40-pound bass with, you know, a bag of books gets to be pretty heavy. And we usually organize things in binders like this. We also wanted them to understand that we could build set lists. Set lists would be something that they could see and use on stage. Like Joe said, we wanted this to be really a performance app. We didn't want it just to be something that just housed all our music. So this is what we came up with. We had most before our look was a lot more a table layout, and then we kind of changed things up, which maybe was a good thing or a bad thing. I don't know. It slowed us down a lot. But let me just show you how Gigbook works. So if I go back to the all scores library here, it says that I have about 385 scores, but I mean that's really not true. If I go into collections, so collections are any books or binders or books that you've scanned in, or me being a music teacher, I teach K-5 elementary music actually. I have lots of packets of books. So for example, if I were to go into like this, I have a jazz fake book that I sometimes use. I mean, there's 488 scores there. So not only do I have the 300 and so individual scores, but I have, I mean, literally thousands of pieces of music at my disposal. The other thing we wanted to do was to make Gigbook fairly easy to set up. Yeah, we'll talk about that. Fairly easy for musicians to organize and get their head around. For example, we have binders. You can organize all your tunes into binders. And binders are, you know, basically folders on the iPad, right? But But with a little bit of a twist, I guess. One is that you can have the same song in multiple binders, and you can have subsets of those binders for you know, your different things you do. This is one of the groups I play in. We play Celtic music, and you can see I have access to any of my tunes. I can call up a song if I wanted to. If I was looking for a song, I have a search window if I needed to find one, or I can just simply click on one of these. I do the Azalea the Waltz, I guess. And my music's going to come up, and it's right here. This happens to be a chord progression chart. And I could create a binder fairly quickly here. One of my groups that I play in is called the Wax Wings. And we play a collection of traditional stuff. We also play some stuff that we wrote. So to make a binder, I just simply click on the plus button, type in the name of this. And from there, I can fill that binder with any of my songs that I need to. But of course, we can cross-reference it. We can have ways to add metadata to all these songs. So I can add a genre or a composer or a collection. In this case, I'm looking for anything that originally that any of the bandmates members did. So this is one of our band members. We've got them. We're back to composers again. These are some of my songs. Oops, I didn't do that. That's awesome. And one more prolific writers. The RF kids over here. So now I have 10 original songs in this binder, so when we go to play a set, sometimes we're asked to play covers, sometimes we're asked to play originals. I can easily call up any of our originals when I need to, when I'm on the stage. Great.
And it makes it easy to create a set, because it's referenced in the binder.
Right. So the other thing that we wanted to do, like I said, is we wanted to make sure that musicians can use this on stage. The iPad's a pretty small viewing size, and so there's two things. One, sometimes as musicians we're playing and we're looking at printed music, and sometimes we're many of us, Joe plays drums, and many times his set lists are just typed out notes from one song to the next. He doesn't actually look at music all the time. So when we developed our set lists we thought needed to be a couple things. One, easy to make. You should be able to make a set list in a couple minutes or while I'm at rehearsal. Should be able to organize that set list, being able to move tracks, move songs around. But when we get up on stage, we wanted our set list to be a different view. We also didn't want to accidentally delete or edit a piece of music. We just wanted to play that piece of music. So we built in a what's called a performer's view, and so the performer's view just shows those names of those tunes. And so if I was playing these songs, I have my key, I know what the tempo is, I know what the meter is. And if I needed to actually see that piece, I can go ahead and click on this piece, and it'll flip over and everything's sequential. So if I'm going to the next song comes up in order two, and I can go ahead and I can play my piece. We built Gigbook to work with a bunch of third-party pageless turners. There's about, I think, five now. One USB, or maybe two USBs. And
I think three wireless. And two.
Three, yeah. Which seems to be a big market. A lot of musicians are using it. We also, in this latest version, we added what we call a performer's metronome. So that's this little thing that's floating up here on the top. And we've used on our iPhones metronomes and stuff like that, but we wanted it to be actually linked to the song. So when you're playing a song, it depends on the gig, but sometimes you have to go from one song to the next, and you need to be on the new tempo, and your heart's racing, and you always tend to play a little bit faster. And So we developed a metronome that can be, that when we go to set it, it looked very familiar for musicians. It looked like all the electronic metronomes that they were going to use. But also then once we are actually viewing it in the score, it could be placed anywhere along the top of the score so it's not in the way of any music. It has a timer so that it doesn't keep blinking at you, because most musicians don't need that. Once they get the song started, they're not actually following the metronome anymore. So that's our thing.
That's our cue.
So anyway, that's what the metronome looks like in score, and this is the setup of it.
All right, we have time for some questions.
How do you find songs in your big fake book?
How do I find songs in the fake book?
Yeah, you've got that big, you pulled open that 448 page fake book. How do you find songs in it?
We have something called Super Bookmarks that lets you take songs out of that and put them into the library.
So the idea is as you're using that fake book, but you know, you've imported a book, or like I said, I have scores from
scroll through, find a song, just Super Bookmarks, name it.
And then you can use that. Then you can use that song in your setlist as an individual. So kind of the idea is as you're using it, not the idea that you would have everything right away, right when you first imported, 10,000 songs.
Sure.
But over time, you would eventually start to extract those things so that the Gigbook then would house all of those.
I was curious about your device integration stuff. You said you could integrate with USB page turners.
There's a couple companies that are making a USB page turning device, so it's hands-free, and also a Bluetooth page turning device. So when you're up on stage, you just tap with your foot in the page.
Does the USB device connect to the camera connection kit? And then,
exactly, yeah. And
what API do you use?
I don't know because I'm not the developer.
Okay.
But just to, when you plug that in, it kicks back a message saying it's not compatible, but it's still compatible. We're basically just using the page forwarding buttons, right? So page forward, page up, page down, to advance it, and it seems to work. Apple could pull that any time, but we're hoping they're not.
It's useful to know.
yeah, in the back.
Have you given any thought to partnering with like an online marketplace that sells sheet music, like say Amazon, where you can actually purchase sheet music in the right format of PDF of what you're using and actually bring it right into the data?
Yes, we have, and we've
contacted Hal
Leonard and who is a big publishing company.
Yeah, huge publishing company, and so we're in the process of trying to get that incorporated.
Because obviously that would be the best, right? Yeah. We don't, in the, Joe was, I talked too long, in this year we have two more big updates that are going to come, and one of them, of course, is going to be annotations, to be able to add those kinds of things, because those are really important, and the other would be to be able to page, use for repeats and stuff like that, to work with those.
You synchronize across musicians?
Yeah, we don't want to talk about that yet, but yeah, we're working on that.
Take one more question.
Yeah, we don't do MIDI files.
No, and right now only PDFs, but yes, that our plan is to get other
file formats.
So are you going to be able to do incrementation without, are you talking about key shifting?
Yeah, you can't do that on a PDF, obviously, because it's set. But if we can import a MIDI file or something like that, then we can talk about changing keys. Yeah.
Thank you. Michelle Bloom and Chris Atkinson, who are going to talk about their Paint for Kids app. So,
thank you. Hi, I'm Chris Atkinson, and this is Michelle Bloom, and we develop iPad apps for children. I'm going to talk real briefly about the app itself. It's relatively simple, so I should be able to get through it without time constraints.
And then Michelle's going to talk briefly about the iPad and its use for education and some possible things we could see it being used for in the future, especially around young children. Before I get too into it, I should give a little bit of brief history about us. A year ago, neither Michelle or I had ever done any programming. So we're both really relatively new to this. And as much as we're going to talk about the app, I'll probably give a little crash course about some of the problems that we encountered along the way, and if any of you are considering that path, what you might try to avoid.
And Michelle, a little bit about yourself.
Both of us are University of Oregon graduates, go Ducks. And my background is in journalism and multimedia, and Chris is psychology, and he worked as a teacher at Head Start for preschool. So kind of those combined just skills that we have really kind of helped us create this iPad app.
Okay, so this app's demographic is really young children, so we built it with kindergartners and preschoolers in mind. So we tried to simplify it as much as possible. So here on this main screen, the only options the kids really have are changing between colors. A couple other features we did, we made the buttons larger to simplify it for kids. We removed a couple of the features that would be more applicable to parents, like getting out of the app to rate it or getting online, that we didn't want kids escaping, essentially.
Undo.
Yeah, undo, deleting it, yeah. So the biggest hurdle that we had really was trying to find ways that kids could break the app and preventing that. The first thing we did when we tested it, we noticed that other apps, when kids used it, I'm not sure this will take. It won't rotate on the screen, but one of the big things we did with testing was we noticed that children often would hit this lower bar with their hands and change the colors. So we made it so that as you turn the iPad around, the bar moves, it stays in the same position, and the icons just reorientate each other. So nothing fancy compared to what we saw from Joe or Tony. But simplicity was what we had in mind. Let's see.
So you can delete it.
You can delete it, you can save a screenshot to your device, and you can email it to a friend. You can turn the sounds off when parents think it's sick of their child. But this app we developed about 4 months ago. It was one of our first ones coming in as a developer. So we really ran into a lot of hurdles, expecting it to be much simpler than it was. And there are unlimited amounts of resources out there for developers, but I'm sure you guys know that finding those resources isn't always the easiest. So as a new developer, if I could really go back and give myself a couple tips, it would be, as you learn things, make sure you really implement it. Don't just read a book, actually practice some code. The forums are really awesome, but the developer documentation is much, much better. Learning it yourself from square one can save you a lot of headaches rather than following someone who gives you bad advice. Yeah, the Stanford videos are amazing. And I guess what I'm learning now is design. It's easy to start off on little apps like this and feel like you can do it as you go, which really is not the case once you start to look at apps like our last two presenters showed, where the features are just limitless. And if you try to build something like that as you go, I've learned the hard way, it is going to be a big, big nightmare. So, thank you a lot. Michelle's going to talk a little bit about some of the things that we see for the future, and hopefully we can be showing something a little bit fancier before long.
So I want to talk a little bit about the iPads and education, and just there's just unlimited areas that this can go. And young children are just, they get the iPad more than 50-year-olds I've met. You know, I had a 2-year-old showing his grandma how to use it. It's amazing. it was this app, and he's 2 years old, and he gets it. And I didn't have to show him, my little cousin, I didn't have to show him how to use it. He saw me use it, he didn't ask any questions. It's like a child learning a new language. I think they just get it. Well, you don't need to see it anymore. So where is the iPads, where are they gonna be used in education? Well, if you look at Tillamook School District right now, they are implementing in the fall in their science classrooms for middle school, the iPad. They're completely replacing their textbooks, their science textbooks, with iPads. And they expect to save, over the next few years, hundreds of thousands of dollars. And so, it's just such an intuitive device, and it's so engaging that it's just going to simply replace all the other media for learning, I really think. Maybe not the iPad in general, but touch and this kind of interface. So that's really where we want to go, and we'd like to use this opportunity to encourage anyone who's interested in the iPad's use in education to contact us, talk to us. We'd love to collaborate with people who are interested in this kind of idea. And the app is available on the iTunes store for $1.99. Or we can give you a promo code if you come up. Any questions? Yeah. Oh, it's Paint for Kids. Yes.
My nieces use Doodle Bug on my iPhone a lot. I can never do a bug.
Yeah, yeah.
Right. And one of the things they love about it is that they can just give it a shake and it erases, so they don't need to know the lead. They don't know if they're, and they are 2 and 4. Mm-hmm. The 4-year-old's teaching the 2-year-old how to do it. It's pretty amazing. And so did you not put the shake feature in because you're worried that they're going to, like, drop it?
You're right. We actually started with the shake for delete, and what we noticed was with the iPad versus the iPhone is if you have a similar threshold for the shake, you really have to be shaking that thing. Right. And if you set the threshold to more acceptable range, it found like it would be deleted unintentionally sometimes, where it's like, hey mom, look what I made, oh, it's gone. So we found that creating that kind of fail-safe backup button worked well. So yeah, we did toy with it a little bit. It was the combo, I think, of trying to cut what we didn't have time for. I think we spent about 3 weeks on this, and this was about 4 months into our learning curve. So we were we're proud of it for what we did at the time, but our bar has been raised pretty significantly in the last 6 months.
Any other questions? All right, thank you guys. Okay, next up we've got Kelly White, who's gonna demo Alchemy. Don't forget, you've got your tokens, so we're gonna do voting at the end. So make sure you're paying attention to your favorites.
I'm not good, if you can't start the clock yet.
Okay, we'll start. We need a full
10 minutes. Thank you.
Okay, are you ready? All right.
No, I'm not ready.
Okay, so I have a Windows phone. I'm a Windows phone type of guy. Don't laugh. And I built a game for the Windows phone called Alchemy. And some of you may have played a game called Doodle God or Alchemy on the Android phone. And we all get our roots from an old DOS game called Alchemy, actually. There's a couple more on the iPad and on the iPhone. The idea is that you start out with these four basic elements. Air, earth, fire, water. I want to say wind, but it's not one of them. And you're going to drag and drop and combine. And as I discover new elements, I hear sounds like it sounds similar to maybe an Xbox Live achievement, though it's not the same sound. And I'm going to delete some of those. Do that. Find out information about the game, how to play it. That's a lot of words. That's way too much to read. I'll talk about how I know that's too much to read. Go ahead and clear the board. Let's add some more. So this, you see ads in here. This is a trial version. And I have two versions. One is a paid version, one is a free version. The free version is ad supported, and you can unlock up to 100 different, discover up to 100 different elements. For the trial version, you can only discover up to 20. And I'm not gonna go through the time to discover 20 right now. I want to talk about the numbers that I'm getting from the marketplace. There is a settings pivot here. We can clear the progress and start all over, and people seem to use that, especially with the free version. They'll go down a path and they'll identify 100 different elements, then they'll back up and they'll go down a different path. They can rate the app and go into the marketplace and do that. And putting that in there has been really helpful. In 4 weeks, I've got 40 plus reviews with this game, and the free version has got 30 plus reviews. This is an idea that I had from the Android version, which was suggested on. And I have 150 emails waiting at home for me to go home and read. And people, they're suggesting this, they're engaging me. They're submitting bugs. And some of these people are saying, how do I create an ad? How do I create a house? And those aren't the bugs that I like, but I'm getting bugs that were talking about performance on different phones earlier on, and problems with the Nodo update. Previous to that, and so I was able to address that immediately. It was really, really, really helpful. This free version, one thing I want to show on this, that's washed. If I try to undo something here, I'm told that I can't do that. This is something that is tied to the full version only. So they're encouraged to upgrade, purchase the full version, and I'm seeing success from that. So that's the app. There's more interesting information about it. If you want to play with it, you can. What I want to talk about, the information that I have from this right now. So this paid version was published not quite 4 weeks ago. The free version was almost 3 weeks ago. And when I submitted these to the Microsoft Marketplace, I'm getting 3 days from when it's submitted to when it's approved. And that's awesome. This last update that I did a week ago today, it took a 24-hour turnaround from when I submitted an update to an already approved app before that gets published to the marketplace. So that's something that's very, very cool, very nice. This cost me $100 to get into the marketplace and get my account, and $500 for graphical assets. I spent about 225 hours building this and going through and doing the different updates. The phone marketplace, just for your information, it has 14,000 different apps out there, 8,500 of which are games. So there's definitely an opportunity there. The average price on a game is going to be $1.78. Xbox Live titles, which you see out there on the phone, range anywhere from $3 to $6, and they don't have any problem collecting that amount of money. Doodle God and Doodle Devil, which I aspire to be like, they charge $3 for theirs, and they're having success that's really, really good. So what I decided to do is I decided to price my app at $1, and this is something that I struggled with for probably about 2 weeks.
I don't think that I've invested enough time in there to charge more than a dollar. I think people will look at that and they'll say, yeah, it's worth a buck. You know, it's not worth more money. And the more that I really thought about this, I came to believe that I could get, and this is a belief, okay? And I haven't tested this, but you know, I really believe that I could get, you know, 3 to 4 times the amount of sales at a dollar than I could at $1.99. So identifying that was really important. Where it sits right now in the marketplace, okay? The paid version and the full version. And you know, out of 14,000 apps, I'm in the top 100, or in the top 50 for the free. If you go into the games category, and then into the puzzles and trivia, you know, the free version sits here in the top 10. And in puzzles and trivia, you know, I'm at number 14, and that's competing against Xbox Live. If I remove Xbox Live titles from this paid category, and I look at this, my game sits at number 29 across all paid apps on the phone, Windows Phone, number 9 in games, and number 3 in that puzzles and trivia category. So I'm really excited about this, you know? I mean, it hasn't been around that long, and it feels like it's going like this. Now, I need a reality check here with people on other platforms. What's it like, you know, on real environments where there's, you know, millions and millions of phones and users? Ad revenue. We'll get to that. The number of downloads that I have, and this is a week old. This is information that I get from Microsoft. 20 days, Alchemy's got roughly 2,000 downloads, and the free version in 11 days has 9,000 downloads. So that's some of the numbers that I'm getting upfront initially. My ad revenue, if you come back to this and you look at the paid downloads there, right? $750, so Uncle Bill takes his 30% and the rest is mine. For ad revenue, I'm using Microsoft Ad Center. They're gonna take their 30% of that and I get the rest. Those are my eCPMs, my impressions, how much I've made, and about half the amount of time. So there's ad revenue that can be made. Don't leave that on the table. Take that money. But I really think that, you know, money is there in sales. And you can sell an app and you can make a lot of money from it. And if it's done right, if you do the trial mode, let's talk about trial mode. So I put in a feature, this last update that went out a week ago. So since April 18th, this is real-time numbers, as of noon today, you know, 270 people have installed the trial version, 50 of those have upgraded to the paid version from the trial, and so that gives me conversion rate that's very similar to what Xbox Live is targeting. That makes me feel good about where I'm at right now. Sweet, I got plenty of time. So we're gonna talk about, you can't see this, and I'm sorry, analytics information. So Preemptive has a great product for Windows Phone, for Android also, and for RIM, for analytics, and it's just kind of drag and drop. The number that you want to see here is that this last completed message winds up being 10:45 this morning. So real-time information, right? This is the paid version. And so I've got up here about 2,000 runs daily. That's how much people are using it. Down here in the bottom right, I see different features that people are using. And if I go and expand this, and you can't read this here, I'm sorry. But here's where I get, you know, the installed the trial version, converted trial version to paid version, show general help, number one. Okay, so that's 2,900 uses. And if I come back here, I can see that my unique users is 7,500. So that might not be right, but you know, people are really, they're using that help a lot. Now if I jump over here and I see where it's being used geographically, Europe and US, that's good to know. I can get a report of the difference. At startup, I'm tracking their culture. What is the culture setting on that phone? And that lets me know where people are really using it. You know, what is it from? And so with that, I can know that, you know, I know that US is 50% of the app usage for this app, and that German is 10% almost. So let's jump over here to the free version. It's doing well. 27,000 times the show general help feature has been clicked. with about 30,000 unique users. So this app could be a little bit more help. People, you know, they click on the help, but maybe an animation tutorial when it starts up that lets them know what they can do. Features, where this is being used worldwide. So these are some of the trends that I have. They're interesting. The questions that I have for you guys is, you know, how does it stack up against other platforms?
Take some questions.
Yeah.
How do you market this pre-launch and post-launch?
The question was, how did I market this pre-launch and post-launch? I had zero marketing. I published it, and people started finding it immediately. When I was at the Mix conference in Vegas last week, you know, I was handing out a business card to some people that had the game on it. I got some of those business cards here, so you don't forget about my game, please. But yeah, with your Windows phone, you all have Windows phones, right? No marketing whatsoever. It's just kind of organic here. Yeah.
The analytics, I wasn't clear. Is that provided by Microsoft, or is that the third-party library you put in?
So. Yes, yes. So the how is the analytics provided? The analytics is provided by a company called Preemptive. It's a third-party software that I actually, they partnered with Microsoft. They have a version that they release for free for every Windows Phone developer out there. It's part of your, if you sign up for the marketplace, you get access to this. They've got a paid version for professional use. Whatever, there's supposedly more information there, more reporting information, to be able to export that. They do have a version for the Android, but I don't know pricing or anything on that. I can put you in contact with those people if you want.
So it's kind of officially sanctioned by Microsoft, they're saying.
Totally, it is so awesome. I mean, it's like drag and drop, because it's taking that bytecode and it's reflecting into it, it's attaching attributes to different method calls. So, I mean, I don't have to get in there and basically put in what I want to track. Really slick.
Questions?
Oh, we got one. Yeah. Outside of like like using the analytics for, you know, to track revenue and users, using the analytics to make changes in the the user experience.
So the question is, do I use the analytics to track or to do feature development essentially? And the answer to this is yes. I had a talk when I was mixed with the CMO of Preemptive. Sebastian Holson, and one of the things that they talk about that they do, which is different than anybody else, is that, you know, analytics is being used for development, for feature development. You're seeing what people are using and what is working, what is not working, and where you should invest those new efforts, essentially, right? It's so much more valuable than, you know, and I don't want to offend anybody, but, you know, what is the ROI on the marketing campaign? That's important to track. And this is a different type of importance, and I think it's maybe perhaps more important what my app will do in the future and where I will spend my resources in the future. Thanks, guys.
Thank you. Okay, we have one final demo tonight, and then we get to vote. Yeah, thanks. We've got Daniel Wood and Reggie Weidman with the Heat Tracker app.
Their affinity for technology projects. So they came to us and they asked us to help them develop this app. The need that they saw was that, you know, on a Friday night after work, you know, you're trying to figure out where to go. You might go on to Foursquare and see where your friends are. You might go on to Facebook and see where your friends are. The problem is, you know those people already. Right? Yeah, for what it's worth. So maybe you don't want to go there. So what they thought is they said, well, there are all these APIs out there. So why can't we have an app that, you know, geolocates, that develops a heat map that shows you where people are, people that you might be interested in meeting who maybe you don't know. So they came to us and they asked us if we could make that happen, and we did. And that app is called Heat Tracker. And playing the app is way more interesting than hearing me, so I'm now going to hand the microphone off to Daniel to talk about how it works.
So yeah, we had a lot of fun putting this together. Big shout out to some of the other minds behind it. Out of Chicago, Kevin Drew Davis, who is an ex-Portlander, used to live in the neighborhood and actually work at White & Kennedy. He's now out of Chicago. He originally concepted this for one of their clients, and they presented it to them, and didn't necessarily fly off the shelves to that client, and they thought, well, gosh, this is probably still something that we find interest in. And so they went a little skunkworks route and made this happen and worked with us to bring it to life. So we had a lot of fun with that. So Heat Tracker, in its essence, is a very simple mashup. It's a visualization of Foursquare. It's looking at check-ins by venue versus by people. Typically, as Reggie was saying, you follow a certain set of people, wonder where they are and where the hotspot is. But when you're in Austin at South By, or you are in a new city and you don't know what's around you, you just want to see maybe where people are at. Or maybe you are in the city that you're used to and you want to go somewhere that you're not going to get mobbed. And you want to say, okay, well, good, no one's in my favorite restaurant. Let's go over there. So there's a couple different ways to look at it. You can scan it and look at it by pins. So there are five different pins. Five or six. We just added one recently. And we'll show you New York has a special pin right now. They're a little further on in their nightlife than we are today. You can look at it in a list view and see essentially by how many check-ins. And some have called this the wingman of apps because you can click in and start to see what's going on. And you can see male to female ratios, different logins. And you can click down and say, gosh, what's going on at 24-hour fitness? Maybe I should go and meet somebody or click in and take Foursquare to another level of actually being able to visualize who has checked in. How it works is it caches the last 3 hours of check-ins per venue. So it is semi-real-time. There's a slight delay. We have to pull everything through Foursquare and mash it up with Google. But there's a lot of fun with it because one of the things that you can't do with just Foursquare by itself is go to other towns, whether it's your hometown or somewhere on the other side of the world, and see what's going on there. So let's go ahead and check out New York right now in real time. The longer the spinning dial, the more spots that it's pulling up. And we'll look at it in a map view because that's always more interesting. So you see the green pin. We're artificially setting a latitude longitude and essentially spoofing Foursquare to think we are there right now. And it's got a lot going on, so it's still loading. Foursquare is tied to Amazon Web Services, so we had some interesting pieces. So you can see that New York has a lot going on, and we have an atomic pin that can tell you about what's happening at the Tribeca with 22 check-ins since 4 o'clock there. And you can start to see who the people are over there. We can go around the world, look at Tokyo. It's interesting to see what the LBS, the location-based services, participation is in different regions, particularly weekends and evenings when people start to really heat it up, for no pun intended. So we think this has a lot of room to grow. After diving into it, making it happen, there was a lot of thought about why couldn't this be a mobile web app. So we're looking at different opportunities there, and even other monetary opportunities between just an ad mob app. This was really kind of a 0.5 release that we put together in a rapid fashion, got it out before Valentine's Day, and we launched it after New Year's. So it was a pretty rapid pace of how everything came together, and we see a lot of opportunity for it to grow into other places. We're also seeing a lot of other partners that are interested beyond this Foursquare. This was an initial opportunity to work with Foursquare closely, and if anyone's tried to work with Foursquare before, it is a very interesting partnership. So I'll leave it at that. From there, I wanted to just show you can filter. So if you're only interested in the guys or the ladies, if you want to see the nightlife only, all sorts of different things. So there are some fun things that happen here. So we can
show you one other one.
You think Vegas? Okay, we'll check on Vegas real quick here.
It's where I prefer to be right now.
Yeah. There we go. We'll give Taisha some tips of where to go next week. Okay, so it's going to give us the green pin. It's going to think about it. And the other beauty is that we can, where's the strip here? I'm not a native Vegas attendee. It's right here. Okay, there it goes. All right. Just a slight delay. So where to go in Vegas? Yeah, Caesars, yes, Bellagio, and the whole desk. So the other thing we wanted to do is create a quick way to flip through these so you can just kind of do next in this view. So a lot of fun, a lot of places to grow with it. And One of the things we did is launch this at South by Southwest and had a fire starter party. And we have one extra large t-shirt here that we wanted to give away.
QR code
on the back, of course. And, absolutely, because you want people right behind you with their phone. So what we wanted to do was give that to the most recent person to check in at Urban Airship tonight. So with that in mind, we have Julian P. There you go. Julian P. is one. There we go. Thank you for participating in location-based services.
I think we're all done early.
2 minutes early.
Beat that. Look at that. So we get 10 minutes of questions, right?
Yeah.
Julian, do you want to come get your shirt?
Are there questions?
Go ahead.
Getting Foursquare on the phone.
No. you know, our developers are not here right now, so I can talk from a distance. It was a true partnership. The service was started from our friends in Chicago, and then we added additional Google API pieces to that service, and then we collaborated with UX, and they did the design, and we did the development. It was a real great collaboration in that sense. The biggest challenges were working within how Foursquare organizes and kind of nests information. And so wanting to kind of work backwards by the type of venue versus just, you know, give me all the nightlife, and then essentially how we have to scan across things is a little bit challenging. Other challenges we had were, gosh, I think that was primarily it, and just making sure we're getting the caching. We're caching so often so that we're not hitting the service too often, even though that we have a priority access that's still limited, and we didn't want to be too taxing on that. So yeah, just finding that happy throttle medium, I think, was probably the biggest challenge. Question back here?
Yeah, how does the hotness scale for 22 people checking in New York is high now, but if it close up at 100, then we have to
That's a good point. So that's one of the features we're working on, is giving users the ability to adjust their heat ratings, so to speak. So, and also to set push notifications. So being able to say, hey, if my favorite venue has hit 30 check-ins, send me an alert. Tell me about it. Or more importantly, you know what? I'm in Austin during South by Southwest, and if it doesn't have 50 plus check-ins, I don't think it's that hot. So being able to have that sliding scale opportunity, I think, is something that we're really working toward to tailor make it toward, you know, different situations. Because, you know, Monday night in Portland versus, you know, Friday in Austin is completely different. But the same person could be using the same app in that situation. Just want to adjust it for that. Did that answer? No, you don't, and that's an interesting element. The question was, do you need to be a Foursquare user to use it? Now, that was actually one of our recommendations in the marketing of this, is have all the benefits of Foursquare without giving any details about yourself, quite frankly. I mean, you can scan it, see what's going on. Everyone that's participating is sharing all of this information publicly. We're not going through anything private. Everyone's opted in to share all of this information. So yeah, you can get a really interesting visualization of what's going on and not have any commitment to it.
Yeah, I think the only thing you get, if you're not logged in, you can't see detailed profile information on an individual.
Yeah, so.
But, yeah. Here's Dan.
We'll do a little Ashton Simpson here. So with that, you can't click down and get the headshots. Essentially, you would get in Foursquare to that depth other than a thumbnail that you share. But I still think that's a little bit more information than Steve Jobs is getting right now, so we're in good shape. Okay, Michelle?
I'm just curious, how many people do you have working on this project?
Good question. Off and on, I would say we have a half dozen locally and probably a dozen in Chicago that worked on this across the time frame. Right back here?
Yeah. As a restaurant
owner,
I'm not just as a marketing person. How can I increase my business?
come and see me after, we'll talk about
it.
Okay. We've got two more questions, I'm told.
Yeah.
Okay. Right back here.
Have you had any concerns over kind of been rulings on free speech about saying that video theater's on fire?
Absolutely. So it is not on fire. The marriage club is cool. Okay, last question, Reddit.
Are you considering any other types of visualization, like an actual heat map?
That's a good point. There's another app from some folks in the Bay Area that was all around figuring out what genders were checking in at what venues, and it was a true heat map, so it kind of radiated like a kind of a geological survey, lighter and lighter. If you need that, good. But we haven't yet. We really enjoy this so far with the icons from a distance, being able to get a list view at the same time. I think our intent is to move more into customization, and maybe other visualization patterns might come out of that, but we're definitely open to suggestions. So. With that, I want to thank you guys for having us. And if you have any other questions, come find us after.
Great. So that's our last demo. I want to thank all of the presenters, and especially Chris and Michelle for presenting and filming tonight, which is not a small feat. So you've got all got your tokens, right? These handy tokens you've been holding on to for an hour. All right, so we've got jars out on your way out where you picked up the name tags. You can drop your tokens in the jar for the app that you liked the most. And then we'll post it on our website and make sure that the app owners know what their standing was in the end. Thanks so much for coming out tonight. Is there still time left in the Blazers game? Has it started? It's what? It's still going on. Still have time to make it. All right. So, thank you guys. Any questions? I forgot to ask that. Are we good? All right. Have a good night. Thank you.